Good morning. Please come to Ind AS 28 again. What is Ind AS 28? Investment in associates and joint ventures. Joint venture is defined in Ind AS 111. When there is a joint arrangement, there is a joint control, okay, and the parties are entitled to share in net asset of that joint arrangement, then it is a joint venture. So further accounting of joint venture will be done under Ind AS 28. So this standard is very easy, but then you can be asked a question where in the same problem there is a subsidiary also, associate also, and joint venture also. So subsidiary will be consolidated as per Ind AS 110. That is, all assets, liabilities will be recorded, NCI will be recorded. But for associate and joint venture, this standard will apply, which is called equity method of consolidation. Okay. So what is equity method of consolidation? We will see in this chapter. First, let us revise or go through some key terms that we are going to use in this chapter. Like, for example, the standard is applicable to associate and joint venture. So who is an associate? Associate means an entity over which the investor has significant influence. You are an investor and you have invested in shares of another company. If it can be proved that you exercise significant influence over the other entity, welcome to Ind AS 28. Is it right? So this chapter will use this word significant influence. Control word is used in Ind AS 110. Joint control word is used in Ind AS 111. And this significant influence is a term which we are going to repeat again and again in Ind AS 28. So then you are interested in knowing what is significant influence. Significant influence means, it is printed below, the power to participate. Power to participate in the financial and operating decision policy of the investee, but not either control or joint control over those policies. Because if you have control, apply Ind AS 110. If you have joint control, then it is a joint venture or joint operation. So it should neither be control nor joint control, but you have the power to participate. Example, suppose there are 7 board members and you have appointed, say, 1 or 2 board members. So what these board members have the power? They have the power to participate in the financial and operating policy decisions. But 1 or 2 board members out of 7 can neither control nor jointly control the decision. You can only participate. You can influence, but not control the decision. That means you can't take the decision that this is how it should be done. But yes, of course, you can influence the decision making process. You will also put your views, which will be heard by others. Okay. You will also argue, counter argue, debate, but you cannot take the decision. Power to participate in the decision making process is also a big power. Now the next is, what is equity method of accounting? This whole standard is about equity method of accounting. So in equity method of accounting, we will first recognize the investment at cost. First investment will be recognized at cost. So if you make investment in associate or if you make investment in joint venture, so what entry you will pass on day one? Investment account debit to bank, assuming you have made the payment, or to vendor. Okay. And then what you will do on every reporting date? You will measure, calculate the post acquisition change in the investor's share of net asset of the investee. Why will the net asset change? Because the subsidiary, so not subsidiary, the associate or the joint venture may have earned profit. Then only the net asset will change. Yes or no? Say yes. So you will calculate your share in that net asset. You will calculate your share in that change in net asset and increase the carrying amount of investment with a corresponding effect in either consolidated P&L account or or OCI. If the associate has recorded the gain in consolidated P&L account, we will credit consolidated P&L account. But there are some gains or losses which are recorded in OCI. So in that case, our share in that OCI will also be presented in OCI. For example, associate may record revaluation gain in OCI. Associate may record actuarial gain and loss. Actuarial gain and loss in OCI. In that case, we will record our share in that in our consolidated OCI. Is it right? Debit effect will remain same. Simple, you remember, when their net asset increases, my investment value will increase. When their net asset decreases, my investment value will decrease. So the reason is that as an investor, as a company, as an outside potential investor or investor, as a stakeholder, I get to know how that investment is performing. Am I right? Why this complicated accounting system is designed? I need to know the performance of the associate and joint venture also. In the absence of this standard, what will happen? You will just get one line item in the balance sheet. Which line item? Investment in associate. That's it, either at cost or fair value. But that does not help you to understand how the associate or joint venture are performing. Is it right? So if they are doing good, they are making profit, your investment value will keep on appreciating. If they incur losses, your investment value will decrease. A time will come, it may become zero also. Okay. But because we only have significant influence or joint control, we do not consolidate the entire net asset of the associate or joint venture with us. So somewhere we have found a middle path. On one hand, don't do anything. That is your Ind AS 27. On the other hand, we have Ind AS 110, where we consolidate the entire net asset of the subsidiary. It is somewhere between these two extremes, where we only record our share in the increase or decrease in the net asset of the associate and joint venture. Because here we are not having control. We don't control the resources unilaterally. Okay. Second effect. One effect, I have told you, every time one effect in investment account. Second effect will be either given in consolidated P&L account or in OCI. Depending upon what is that income or expense, what is that income or expense item. How do we know that there is a investor and associate relationship? So there is a benchmark here. What is that benchmark? 20% share in voting power. So up to 50. Normally up to 50. Normally So if your voting power is in this range 20 to 50, it is assumed that you have the ability to exercise significant influence. It is assumed that you exercise significant influence. Unless proved otherwise. Sir, unless proved otherwise means, I can say that even though I have 20% share in the voting power, but I do not participate in the financial and operating decision making process. I am just a passive investor. I have no interest in how the business will be run. I am happy as long as I get dividend, capital gain, etc. Then with 20% or more also, you need not apply this standard. Is it right? But what about less than 20? One more interesting thing. If we are here between 0 to less than 20%, it is presumed no significant influence. Presumed. Unless proved otherwise. Here also, unless proved otherwise. So very interesting situation. With less than 20% also, the standard can be applicable to some entity who exercise significant influence. And with more than 20% also, the standard may not be applicable to certain entities if it can be proved that they do not exercise significant influence. Which means this 20% is not a very strict rule. Not like your income tax laws. The moment you cross even one unit, the rule changes for that. Yes or no? Like for example, I remember, I don't know much. If you hold an asset for 120 days or above, full depreciation. 120 or 180? 182. But the moment you hold it for 181 days also, immediately half depreciation. Here we don't have a strict rule like that. You can cross the boundary little bit and you can still prove that you don't apply in days 28 because you don't have significant influence. And you are before the boundary line only. But still you can prove that I have significant influence and therefore I am eligible to apply in days 28. How do you check whether significant influence is exercised or not? So there are some indication of significant influence. This list is not exhaustive. Paragraph 3. This list is not exhaustive. But these are good indicators of significant influence. Like for example, representation on the board or a governing body, because they take decisions, they discuss financial matters, participation in policy making process, including participation in decisions about dividend or their distributions. Then material transaction between entity and the investee. Material means important, significant transactions. Interchange of managerial personnel. Some key management personnel of one entity also spend time, efforts in another entity. Which means there is a significant influence. If manager of one entity also goes and work in another entity, will he not try to influence that other company? Yes. And then provision of essential technical information. Now come to next paragraph number 4. Potential voting rights. There is an important difference between this standard and a similar standard in accounting standard 23. Because AS 23 is also a part of syllabus. What is the difference? AS 23 does not consider potential voting rights. Potential voting rights means these are not voting rights now, but they can be converted into shares and you can acquire voting rights anytime soon. Is it right? Like for example, you are holding share warrants and options, and which can be exercised by you. The moment you exercise, you will get the voting rights. So while calculating your 20% share, for example, you may also take into consideration potential voting rights like share warrants and options. Then you will check whether significant influence exists or not. Like for example, suppose you are holding right now 18,000 shares, okay, and the company has 1 lakh shares, so your stake is 18%, but you also have share warrants and options which allows you to purchase 10,000 share of the company, which allows you to purchase. So I will consider that whether these options or warrants can be exercised, assuming yes, and this will give me 10,000 share. Of course, this will also increase by 10,000. If I buy 10,000 share, company's share capital will also increase by 10,000. Now I will have 28,000 total share, 1,10,000, convert into percentage. So around 25% approximately. So if you are holding 18,000 share and warrants which allows you 10,000 share, or options to buy 10,000 shares, in this example it is assumed that you have significant influence, because considering potential voting rights share, your stake comes to around 25%. Convertible debenture bonds are also considered, subject to they are currently exercisable. That means if they are going to be converted after 5 years, then no. Now we'll come directly to the accounting part. What is the method of accounting they have recommended? Equity method, both associate and joint ventures. Now in equity method of accounting, what we will do, first point I have told you, so I am not repeating in the notes or in the presentation, when we initially measure at cost, day one, investment account debit to bank account, and then whenever the net asset of the associate or joint venture will change, we will increase or decrease the carrying amount of investment. By passing the entry investment account debit to consolidated P&L account or investment account debit to OCI account, if there is a increase in the net asset in the associate or joint venture due to OCI change, okay, like revaluation gain, foreign exchange gain or loss, or actuarial gains and losses. Then the next thing is we have to check whether the investment that we have acquired includes goodwill or capital reserve. How do we compute goodwill or capital reserve? Same formula like your Ind AS 110, exactly same formula. Check cost of investment, compare it with investor's share of net fair value of associate's identifiable net asset. Now here there is a small difference. I will not consider that NCI because my stake is just 20-30%. So we'll just compare our cost of investment with our share in the fair value of the net asset. Two possibilities are there. A is greater than B. It is called goodwill. B is greater than A, it's called capital reserve. Now here there is a huge difference between this standard and Ind AS 110. If it is goodwill, goodwill is already included in the cost of investment. Goodwill is already included in the cost of investment. Okay. Now, if I put some numbers, you will understand. I purchased an investment for lakh rupees and my share in the net asset is 80,000. So, goodwill is 20,000. Now, how do I present in the consolidated balance sheet? I will just write investment in associate 1 lakh. I don't have to do anything more. This 1 lakh includes goodwill of 20,000. Don't write like this. Some books have written this also, but that is wrong. Write investment in associate 80,000. Write goodwill separately 20,000. This is not to be written. Okay. Investment itself will appear at 1 lakh and which will include goodwill also. So, your job is done. If it is goodwill, no further treatment. Matter closes there. But if there is capital reserve, then I will have a gain on bargain purchase. Then I have a gain on bargain purchase. Capital reserve will be presented separately in equity. That means statement of changes in equity. It is different from AS 23. Slightly. First difference is goodwill is only checked. And if it is goodwill, no further treatment. Second, if it is capital reserve, it is accounted separately in this standard. Whereas in AS 23, whether it is goodwill or capital reserve, you just disclose it in the line below the investment, includes goodwill, includes capital reserve. But here, if it is capital reserve, I will remove it. And it will be presented as a separate line item in the statement of changes in equity. So, same example, only I will change the numbers. Suppose cost of investment is 80,000. Your share in the net asset, 1 lakh. Therefore, there is a gain. You paid 80. And what did you get? Assets of net asset of 1 lakh. So there is a gain on bargain purchase. There is a gain on bargain purchase. So the standard says it will be recognized directly in equity, directly in SOCIE, not to be routed through P&L account or OCI. Okay. Directly in SOCIE, you will write capital reserve on acquisition of associate or joint venture. Now, how do you do this adjustment? So, you have purchased investment for 80,000. But I will write 1 lakh. To bank, 80,000. And to capital reserve, 20,000. So, I will increase the investment value by 20,000. In case of capital reserve, I need to make adjustment. I have to increase investment by 20,000 and I have to credit capital reserve by 20,000. Otherwise, how will capital reserve appear separately? You have to give a contra effect somewhere, na? Step acquisition. What is your query again? Step acquisition 110. What is query? Yeah. Yes. It is like 110 only, but not exactly 110. If goodwill is included in the carrying amount, no further treatment, including no amortization also. Is it right? So just ignore that. The whole investment will be impaired, if at all we have to impair. Separately, goodwill will neither be amortized nor impaired. If required, the whole asset will be impaired. Equity method. Already discussed first entry, second entry, third entry we have discussed. Okay. This standard does not require much adjustment. To remove any doubt, if you have, we do not consolidate assets, liabilities, revenue, expense of the associate or joint venture. We only adjust the carrying amount of investment in the balance sheet and our share in profit in P&L account and our share in OCI in OCI. That's it. What if you receive the dividend from the associate or joint venture? Now, when the associate or joint venture, they pay dividend, their net asset decreases. Their net asset decreases. Do you agree? If they make profit, their net asset increases. So, if they pay dividend, their net asset will decrease. So, we will reduce the carrying amount of investment. Now, here there is an important adjustment. If the associate pays dividend, we receive dividend. Bank account to investment account. Carrying amount of investment is reduced. Sir, why? I have told you. If the dividend is paid, what decreases? The net asset decreases. Am I right? Will distribution of dividend reduce the net asset? Yes. So my chapter says very simple thing. When their net asset increase, you increase the investment. When their net asset decrease, you reduce the investment. That is what I am doing. There is one question also. At the end of this chapter or in your practice booklet, just go to your practice booklet, which I need to discuss. What is that question number? Amar Limited acquires 40% shares of Ram. Question number 8. 13. Okay, 13. On 1st April 20X1, the price paid is 10 lakh. Ram Limited reported a profit of 2 lakh and paid a dividend of rupees 1 lakh. Pass necessary journal entries in the books of Amar Limited. In bracket write on under Ind AS 28. Under Ind AS 28. Because under separate financial statement, the entries will be different. Under Ind AS 28. Okay. Now see the entries. Just check in your book. There are some minor corrections required. First, you will buy the investment for 10 lakh. Is it written there? Investment to bank. Tick, tick. Then your share in the profit of the associate. How much is the profit of the associate? 2 lakh. Into 40%. 80,000. And how much is written in your book? Is it 80,000? Or 2 lakh? 2 lakh. That is institute's answer. You rectify. It should be 80,000. Only your share. Then you receive dividend also. How much dividend they have paid? How much you have received? 80,000. 40% is 40,000. Bank account debit to investment in associate 40,000. So make it 40,000. Now if I ask you, what will be the carrying amount of investment in balance sheet? Then what would be your reply? Carrying amount will be 10 lakh plus 80,000 minus 40,000 is equal to 10,40,000. So carrying amount of investment under Ind AS 28 will be in this example 10,40,000. Agreed? Agreed. Okay. Exemption from applying equity method. These exemptions are similar to exemptions given in which standard? Ind AS 110. Okay. So you may have an associate, you may have a joint venture, but still you may be exempted from applying equity method. If you are exempted from applying equity method, then you follow Ind AS 27 only. Don't follow Ind AS 28. So give me four cumulative conditions which you need to satisfy for exemption. One, the entity is a parent that is exempt from preparing consolidated financial statement under Ind AS 110. If all the four conditions are satisfied, one, it is a wholly owned subsidiary. That entity is a wholly owned subsidiary or is a partially owned subsidiary of another entity, and its owners, including those not otherwise entitled to vote, have been informed about and do not object to the investor not applying the equity method. So your owners have said, okay, we don't have a problem. Enjoy. Second, it is not listed. Third, it is not in the process of being listed. No filing of any kind of statutory document with statutory agencies like SEBI, Securities Exchange Commission. And then its ultimate parent or any intermediate parent prepares CFS, which is available for public use, and that CFS complies with Ind AS. And that CFS complies with, in your book it is written International Financial Reporting Standard, make it Ind AS. And that complies with Ind AS. Written Ind AS? Okay. Come to next paragraph. When an investment is an associate or a joint venture. Now one more type of entity is exempted. That was a general exemption. Okay. Those who satisfy those four conditions in general are exempted. But sometimes there are some investment entities, they are also given exemptions. When an investment in an associate or joint venture is held by or is held indirectly through, so means directly or indirectly, through an entity that is a venture capital organization, or through a mutual fund, or through a unit trust or similar entities including investment linked insurance funds, the entity may elect to major investment in this associate and joint venture at FVTPL in accordance with Ind AS 109. Okay. So that means these are called investment entities. In Ind AS 110 also we had seen that last paragraph. If you are an investment entity, then you are exempted from applying 110. Now it is exempted from applying 28, subject to you apply Ind AS 109 and the investment is presented as FVTPL. And the investment is presented as FVTPL. So you may be investing it directly or you may be investing it indirectly through these organizations. Enjoy, you are exempt. When a portion of the investment in associate or joint venture is held indirectly through venture capital organization or mutual fund, some portion you are managing directly But some portion is invested through venture capital organization or mutual fund. Then you will be exempted from which portion only? Which are invested through mutual fund or this venture capital. Okay. That portion alone will be exempt from the requirement of this standard. While the other portion held will be accounted under equity method. Now one more important paragraph that was not very important for solving a numerical question or even for a theory question, because these are very rare situations. They have mentioned that you have invested through venture capital or mutual fund or some unit linked insurance plans, then you are exempted from applying Ind AS 28. Share of losses in associate. Oh, one small number I will write. Cost of investment purchased 1 lakh. Less share of loss. Our share is 20%. Associate's loss is 6 lakh. So 1,20,000. So I am getting a negative balance. So what normally I will do, if after considering our share in loss, the balance becomes negative, we will show investment at zero value. So investor share of loss of an associate or joint venture is recognized until it exceeds or equals its interest in the associate or joint venture. Beyond that, no further loss is recognized, if any. But then what happens? This investor may recognize additional loss, means it will become a liability in that case. Negative balance means liability. Can you show it as a liability? Yes. If additional losses are provided for and liabilities recognized only, underline, to the extent investor has incurred legal or constructive obligation or made payment on behalf of the associate or joint venture. Again, very exceptional situation. When you have incurred any legal or constructive obligation or has made payment on behalf of the associate, then only you will be recognizing the negative balance, means the liability. Example, guarantee given on behalf of associate. Yes or no? Guarantee given on behalf of associate. Or second example, partly paid shares. What is partly paid share? You have not paid the full amount, which means you have an obligation to pay the unpaid amount. So therefore, in that case, to the extent you have an obligation to pay the unpaid amount, that amount can be called by the associate. Is it right? So in that case, you can disclose that much liability. So if you have given guarantee, if there are partly paid shares, you may be called upon to make the payment. Why they are saying show the investment at nil value? Because you are an equity investor. At the most, what you will lose? Full value of your investment. Beyond that, you can't incur the loss. Only if you have given guarantee, then you can incur the loss. If you have made part payment on that investment, you will be called to pay the unpaid amount. That is why this paragraph. What if the associate starts reporting profit? Will you immediately show the positive balance? No. First, you will adjust the previous unadjusted loss. How much was the unadjusted loss in that example? 20,000, which I have written. So mentally remember, I have a 20,000 rupees unadjusted loss. This year, the associate earns 10 lakh rupees of profit. My share in that, 2 lakh, 20%. What I will do, I will adjust that 20,000 which we have not adjusted earlier, and now the amount of investment to be shown is 1,80,000. Is it right? This is the meaning of this paragraph. Okay, now come to the next paragraph. Uniform accounting policy. Uniform accounting policy means associate, joint venture will follow the same policy which investor follows or venturer follows. But in practical situation, this may not be achievable. Why? Suppose you have an associate, you are holding 20% share. There are other investor who are also holding 80% share. They also have, suppose, significant influence. Then there will be a fight. Everybody will say, you follow my policy. You will follow my policy. Will say, I will not follow anyone's policy. So then what you will do? Make adjustments. Take their financial statement. Make adjustment. And if you can't make adjustment also, then make disclosures. Okay. First priority is same. If not uniform, adjustment. If in extreme case that is also not possible, then normally disclose. And what about the difference in reporting period? Same reporting period ideally should be followed. But if it is not possible, then different period can be followed, subject to the maximum gap should not be more than 3 months under this standard. And if there is a difference in reporting period, suppose associate year ending date is 31st December, ours is 31st March, take 31st December balance sheet, make adjustment for significant event and transaction, prepare another balance sheet and that you will consolidate. Is it right? Now we will continue tomorrow.